Well, hallelujah. Good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. It was exactly 1 year ago this Sunday that I stood here for the last time as pastor of this church. I just see God's hand in things. You know, Richard Starry was supposed to preach today. It's been set up that way ever since Brother Barry knew he'd be gone. And Richard thinks it was the Air Force that took him out of the pulpit today. I happen to know better. God's just making room for the old man to get up here and preach one more time. And I'm so thankful for that. Now, 14 years and one October, I served this church as pastor, and then I've been a year without a pulpit. So you have a little extra element to add to your praying this morning. That is that I will not try to squeeze a whole year's worth of preaching frustration into one sermon. So be praying about that, would you? Before we get into our text, I do have one announcement to make. Last week, Brother Barry told you that today you'd be given a mission opportunity, and that's been delayed 1 week because our mission team wasn't quite ready with all the details, but I want to give you a heads up so you'll know what's coming. The mission committee of this church, along with me, is planning a trip to Moldova sometime in January or February. You'll be given more specific dates. That's the place we're collecting money to buy firewood so they can heat their poor little homes in those little pitiful wood stoves they have where they have no firewood. But we're going to go to that village. We want you to start praying about that. Be prepared. We're going to try to hit a week when you'll have a three-day weekend, you active duty guys, that might help you save some leave time or something. The tentative dates will be given you next week, but just be praying. God, do you want me to go to Moldova on this mission trip? Is there something I can do over there? And let him give you the answer, and then you do whatever he tells you, and we'll be glad to take you with us. We want you to see it with your own eyes. We want you to be there to be part of the victories we see every time we go. I want you to have that blessing. All right, sermon for today. I have a practice I go through many, many months, not every month, but many months. I'll start out on the first day of the month. I'll read Proverbs 1 and 2 and 3, and I'll read whatever chapter of Proverbs corresponds to the day of the calendar month. And I've done that many, many times. And 2 times ago, as I was going through, I came across a verse of scripture that some smart aleck must have sneaked in there because I had never seen it before in all the times I read through it. You know, years ago, wise people took our Bible and they began to break it into categories based upon what kind of literature it was. You know, we got the law, we got the prophets, we got major prophets and minor prophets, we got the gospels, we got the epistles. They did all those things. And one of the categories they came up with, they called the books of wisdom. It's Job, Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, and Song of Solomon make up what scholars call the books of wisdom. Now, I can tell you from having read the Bible through many, many times that all the verses in the Bible are verses of wisdom. But for some reason, God, the Holy Spirit, took these 5 books to bring his wisdom down in a much more personal and applicable way to those of us who really need wisdom. And I want to tell you something right now. The older you get, the more you're going to know you need wisdom. And you may somewhere down the road do like me. You'll turn your attention to the books of wisdom as often as you can to see what God has for you there. It's hard to say when you understand that the entire Bible reflects God's wisdom. It's hard to say that there's one verse of scripture that's more wise than all the others. But this verse I came across the next to last time I read through Proverbs, I believe with all my heart, may be the one verse in all the Holy Bible that encapsulates everything God wants the human race to know. And I'm going to share that with you just in a moment. It tells you everything you need to know for salvation and everything you need to know for sanctification, for that walk with God after you've accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior. It's all here in just a few simple, simple words. And I want to share that with you. I call the sermon simply this. Wisdom is such a simple thing. You know the old thing about if sense is so common, if there's such a thing as common sense, why is there so little of it? If wisdom is so simple, why is there not more? It's because people don't pay attention to what God has given us. Now, I want you to pay attention to this verse of Scripture today, and I hope you'll get it in your heart so deep you can't forget it. You'll have it memorized the time you leave here, and it'll never, ever leave you because it's the simplest rules for living that you'll find anywhere in the Bible. It's Proverbs chapter 23, verse 26, and it says simply this. My son, give me your heart and let your eyes observe my ways. give me your heart and let your eyes observe my ways. That covers it all. Pray with me, please. Father, as we turn our attention here, our hearts, our minds, to your holy word, we just pray that you will let the power flow and the glory roll as we divide the word of life today. I thank you for giving me this verse of scripture. It means so much to me, and I ask you, Lord, to help me give it to them so that it will mean much to them. And I don't know what kind of purpose you have for preaching this sermon here today, but somewhere out there, there's someone who needs this, and we just pray that their hearts are open, they'll receive what you have for them, and do whatever you require when this message is over. Thank you again for the Lord Jesus Christ, all we have in him. We thank you in his precious name. Amen. If all the Bible is wise and there are five books of wisdom, why did God pick out five and focus them in a very personal and very concise way? It's because God puts a great premium on wisdom. In chapter 4, verse 7, he says, wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom. And in all you're getting, get understanding. God wants us to have wisdom and to know what to do with it. Now, let me tell you, share this with you. There are two things in the world that people get confused, wisdom and knowledge. Knowledge is an accumulation of facts, stuff that you know. You ever heard somebody talk about people that are so smart they don't know what to do with themselves? I've met people like that. Wisdom is just an accumulation of facts. You can know a whole lot of stuff and have no wisdom at all. Wisdom is being able to take the stuff you know and apply it to life in order to get a positive result. That's wisdom. So God wants us to have wisdom, and with all our getting, to get understanding. Now, here's we go. This verse, it makes a very, very simple outline. It's just divided in two parts. Number one is, give me your heart. Give me your heart. Can you think of any simpler way to express what it means to get saved? You give your heart to the Lord Jesus Christ. When you give your heart, you understand you give your life. The Bible tells us that from the heart flow the issues of life. Everything about life centers around our heart and flows from our heart. So you give your heart to Jesus Christ, you have in effect given him everything in your life. You've given yourself completely over to him. You have died to self. You have died to the world. You have taken up his cross. You've done all those things when you give him your heart. Now, when I was growing up, there was a term we heard a lot of times. If you gave someone a gift and then later on you went to take it back, like, or you might give one of your toys to one of your friends later on and decide, hey, that's my favorite toy. I'm going to go get it back. You were called an Indian giver. I know that's racist, but that's what they said. I grew up hearing that term. A lot of people come to Jesus pretending to give their heart, and later on they turn into Indian givers, they take it back. Well, see, when you have given it completely to him, you will never take it back again. You will never take it back. Now, this thing about giving your heart to God has been part of the Bible theme from the very earliest days. I have just a few verses of scripture to share with you here, a couple. Back in Deuteronomy 10, verses 12 through 13, God said to Israel, and now, Israel, what does the Lord your God require of you but to fear the Lord your God, to walk in all his ways and to love him, to serve the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, and to keep the commandments of the Lord with his statutes, which I command you today for your good. Serve him with all your heart and soul. Give him your heart. Observe his ways. Walk in all his statutes, which he commands. It's there, right there. Jesus in Luke 10:27, a passage I'm sure you know very well, he answered and said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. God has always wanted people to give him their hearts. And here's why I want to preach this message today. There is a term going around in evangelical circles in America that they call easy believism. It's a concept that says, well, you know, people heard the gospel, they realize if they make a profession of faith in Jesus Christ, the fire insurance gets paid, they don't have to worry about hell anymore, then they can go on and live life any way they want to. Easy believism. The question is, does easy believism save anybody? I think not. And I think our text tells us that, and I think many, many other places in the Bible tell us the same thing. Now, here's the thing about hearts, okay? You probably know the verse in Jeremiah 17, verse 9. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? The heart is deceitful above all things. Now, the Bible, one of the titles that the Bible gives to Satan is the deceiver. He deceives the entire human race. And I fear, as after all my years as a pastor preaching and seeing people make professions of faith and then see their life after that, I am very much afraid that one of Satan's greatest deceits is to have people think, oh, if you prayed a little prayer and made a little public profession and got dunked in some water, you're okay, just go ahead and live now, you're saved. Maybe when you were 8 or 9 years old, you got a little emotional in church or vacation Bible school or something, and you said, oh, I want Jesus in my heart, and didn't have any idea what you were talking about. And then later on, the hormones kick in and the temptations arise, and you, I did that, so I'm okay. I'm just going to go and live any way I want to. I just got to experience everything the world has for me. Deceives you into thinking you're saved when really you aren't. Now, I'm not here this morning to challenge anyone's salvation. But in 2 Peter 1:10, Peter told Christian people, make your calling and election sure. Paul said, examination must begin at the house of God. Judgment must begin at the house of God. And so I want you to think about who you are and what you're doing and what did you do. Are you truly saved today? Have you really given Jesus your heart? Anything less than that, you've been deceived by the devil into thinking something that is not true. When you read about that and say, oh, deceitful heart, desperately wicked, who can know it? The second question is, who would want it? Why would God want us to give him something that is such a mess? Deceitful and wicked, unknowable. God, what's up with that? Well, my answer to that is simply the God of the Holy Bible. He's the one who wants it. This God, he explained himself very completely to Moses the second time he gave the law. You know, he gave the law once and the tablets got thrown down and broken. Moses, come back up here. We're going to do it again. And we're going to give the law again. And this time I'm going to tell you a little bit more about myself than I told you the other time. And it's recorded in Exodus 34, 6 and 7. And the Lord passed before him, Moses, and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abounding in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression sins, by no means clearing the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children's children to the third and fourth generation. That's the God that wants the heart of sinful mankind today. A God who is merciful, gracious, long-suffering, abounding in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity. That God wants the heart of the sinful human race today. Why does he want that? God is in the heart transplant business. I want to tell you that. God is in the heart transplant business. He wants to take that old heart out of you and put a new heart in you. He described it in the book of Ezekiel 36:26. I will give you a new heart, put a new spirit in you. I will take the heart of stone out of your flesh, give you a heart of flesh. God wants to do a heart transplant in sinners. And if we don't give him our old heart, he can't give us the new heart. So that's why he wants us to do these things. He means to do the same thing in your life, in my life, in the life of every person who will repent of their sins and come to him through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I just said a key word there, repent. There are lots of people who make profession of faith. They believe in their mind everything they hear about Jesus. They come professing faith in him. And yet repentance, that change of mind which changes the heart, which changes the will, which changes the lifestyle, has never taken place. It happens particularly, I think, in the lives of a lot of young people because they're innocent. They really are sincere, but they don't really understand what a life of sin is all about yet. And later on, you know, when all those temptations I mentioned before, the hormones, all that stuff kicks in, the peer pressure. If you read the rest of this chapter in Proverbs, he talks about sexual immorality in the next couple of verses, and then a drunkenness, intoxication below that. Those kinds of things that grasp young people when they get in their adolescent years and young adulthood. Sexual immorality, drinking, of the vine of life out there. It may be alcohol. It may be just some other kind of intoxication with pleasure or whatever. Those are the things that God is warning us about. Give me your heart, and I'll defend you against those things. A lot of people make profession of faith, never understanding the power of temptation when it comes on you later on in life. I was that way for many years in my life, so I know exactly what I'm talking about. Now, I said repentance means a change of your mind, your heart, your will, and your lifestyle. The Lord Jesus told us through the Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ Jesus, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. All things have become new. When people used to come to me and having some doubts about whether they're truly saved or not, I would sit and talk with them, and I would ask them to do a little examination. Tell me what has changed since that time you thought you got saved. Has anything changed? And if they say, well, can't really think of anything, I say, well, I don't think your new birth certificate was signed. It doesn't have a date on it. And if nothing changed, you didn't get saved. No, God says, my son, give me your heart and let your eyes observe my ways. That's the second part of the message. This observe my ways. There are certain conflicts in the translation of that one word that my Bible says observe. You call it, have another word in there, but something that means that. It's one of those rare places where two Hebrew words are joined together to form one English word. And by looking at those two Hebrew words, we can get an idea of what God is really trying to say. One of those Hebrew words means to take delight in something. And a lot of the Bible translation, I preached this message down in southern Italy back in September in an Italian church, and their Bible says, let your eyes take delight in my way. Well, that translates one of the words that's used here. But the other word means to guard, to protect, to maintain, to observe and obey. So the two come together. And when I sit down with my little simple mind and start trying to, okay, now what's it trying to say? Here's what it's trying to say. Let your eyes see my way. You walk in my way and be thrilled, be delighted by walking in the way that I lead you. You know, Jesus talked about abundant life. Lots of people who call themselves believers are not experiencing the abundant life. Why? Because they're not walking in the way the Lord wants to lead them. They're not walking in an abundant life. You want the abundant life, you go where God takes you, and that's where you find it. It's a very important thing that we walk in his ways, that we observe his ways, and let him lead us as we go along. Now, pride gets in the way a lot of times with us adults. We think, okay, I'm educated and got a career and I'm professional and I know how to do things and I don't need anybody to guide me now. I got it all figured out and I can go and do my own thing. Well, the Bible has numerous admonitions that tell us that's not true. I'm not going to bore you with all of them, but I'm going to give you a few, and you might do yourself a favor. Open your bulletin, just jot down these references, and you can look at them later and say, what was he talking about there? I don't know. Anyway, in Isaiah 55, 8 through 9, God tells us why it's important that we observe his ways. Here's what the Bible says. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. You and I will never make the high road walking our way, because our ways and his ways are as far apart as the heaven is above the earth. Jeremiah 10:23 sounds a warning to people who think I can do it on my own. Oh Lord, I know the way of man is not in himself. It is not in man who walks to direct his own steps. Huh? That's what God said about you and about me. It's not me saying it about you. God has said it about all of us. It is not in man that walks to direct his own self. Why? He has a heart in him that is deceitful and wicked above all things. And he won't know how to do it. Psalm 14:12, it gets more intense. There is a way that seems right to a man, but its end is the way of death. You can just get out and stumble on. You know, we see a lot of things on the news these days with all the disasters taking place around us. You know, the news calls them natural disasters. I call them supernatural disasters because I figure God's behind them trying to get the world's attention. But they're in their car and they're driving and they come to a road and there's a stream of water flowing along here. Well, I know the road goes around, so I'm just going to, and they plunge into it, and next thing you know, their car swept downstream, they're drowned, and man thinks he knows the way to do it, but the end is the way of death. And God has been gracious enough to warn us about this so we would know, don't go that way. Moving over into the New Testament, John 8:12, Jesus spoke to them again, saying, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. He that follows me, he who observes my ways and follows my ways, will not walk in darkness. The flip side of that is, if you're not following him, you're walking in darkness. Is that not true? We don't like that. We don't want to walk in darkness. I love Romans 8:1. It's one of those hallelujah verses in the Bible, and you really ought to have it ingrained in your heart. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. In Galatians 5:16, Paul wrote, I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. If you get in Proverbs 23, look at those verses after 26. It's exactly what it's talking about, the lust of the flesh, sexual immorality, intoxication with pleasure of life, the desires of life. If you're walking in the Spirit, you will not be deceived into trying to fulfill those things while saying, I'm a child of God, I made a profession of faith. You won't be deceived. Again, that verse in 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ Jesus, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Now, I think Christian people need to learn. There are certain words in your Bible, and you come across them, it's good to put a little circle around them. So when the next time you read that passage, you'll focus on it. All things. Don't ever miss the ALLs when you see them. Don't ever miss the BUTs. But there are certain words you just want to pay close attention to, because they're comprehensive. They change everything. All things have become new. What has become new in your life since you professed faith in Christ as your Lord and Savior? Well, you might say, all things. That's a very large concept. How can we ever deal with all things here this morning, preacher? And I say, well, just fasten your seatbelt and I'll deal with it for you. We're not going to try to touch on all things. But here's what I want you to know. Giving your heart to God through faith in Jesus Christ has got to produce change in your life. And if you see no change, go back and do it over again and get it right this time. You have to change. I know we get confused sometimes about grace and all this stuff. The old hymn, just as I am. Well, that's all God wants, come just as you are. Well, that's true. Just as I am without one plea, that's truly how Christ receiveth me. But once I'm his and he lives in me, just as I am, I can never be. You got that? Someone said you can come to Christ just as you are, but once you come, you cannot stay the way you are. You can take those words, by the way, and it fits right in that song, Just As I Am Without One Plea, the old invitation hymn that's closed Billy Graham Crusade since the 1950s. It fits right there, note by note. At breakfast this morning, I sung it to my wife. And she, out of compassion for you, said, don't sing it over at the church. So you're being spared because my wife loves you. Just as I am without one plea. That's truly how Christ receiveth me. But once I'm his and he lives in me, just as I am, I can never be. Did anything change when you made your profession of faith? You know, Jesus said, by their fruit you shall know them. Jesus told the most religious people of his day, the Pharisees, bring forth fruit worthy of repentance, or fruit that will reflect that you are living a repented life. Your life producing any fruit for the Lord Jesus Christ? I want to just challenge you. Be honest with yourself. Think it over. Have you given him your heart? We can't cover everything that should change. We know if you've truly given Christ your heart, your eternal destiny has changed. We know that, and we rejoice in that. But there's some things right down here at ground level that should change if you truly have given Jesus your heart. And I want to give you four of them this morning. They have biblical backup. I wouldn't share them with you if they didn't come from the Bible. One thing that must change is our affections. In 1 John 2:15 and in many other places we read similar instructions, but here's what it says in 1 John 2:15. Do not love the world or the things of the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. The world can't hold your heart and God hold it at the same time. It's got to be one or the other. Our attitudes should change. In 1 Corinthians 2, the second part of verse 16, Paul tells us we have the mind of Christ. Your attitudes are going to change. You're going to look at the world with the same attitude Jesus looks at it with. In Philippians 2:15, we're instructed, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. You know, our human attitudes can mess us up in so many ways. But if we get back to that old thing that they kicked up several years ago back in the States, what would Jesus do? What would be the attitude of Jesus toward this situation or toward that person or toward this relationship? What would that attitude be? Let that attitude lead us. We need to have the attitude of Christ. Our attachments need to change. I'm giving you the 4A here. You don't know that. Your affections, your attitudes, your attachments. In 2 Corinthians 6:17 and 18, therefore come out from among them, the non-believers, and be separate, says the Lord. Do not touch what is unclean, and I will receive you. I will be a father to you. You shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. Change the crowd you hang with if you have given your heart to the Lord Jesus Christ. Why? Because the crowd you hang with probably has not given their heart to the Lord Jesus Christ, and they will drag you down. Now, let me give you a history lesson. People are always wondering, well, if God is a God of love, why did he tell the Israelites to go in the promised land and kill everybody in there? What kind of God of love would do that? I'll tell you what kind of God. An omnipotent God who knows the end from the beginning, who knows that if the Israelites allow the Canaanites to survive and exist, the Canaanites are going to drag the Israelites down to where they are. See what I'm saying? So many times Christian people think, okay, I'm saved, man, I've got it. It's right in here, I'm just full of it. I'm going to hang with that same old crowd because I'll turn some of them around, man. So I'm just going to keep on going with that crowd that drinks and cusses and tells dirty jokes and, you know. You're probably not going to change any of them, but they're going to change you. And God knows that, so he says, come out from among them. We're to be in the world, not of the world. That's one of the cliches that you've probably heard 1,000 times. Change your attachments. Get with the brothers and sisters in Christ who can build you up, not tear you down. Yes, relate to those other people. You'll never win them to faith in Jesus Christ if you don't relate. But they are not your attachments anymore. You're attached to the family of God. They're on the periphery, and you're doing your best. Our activities have got to change. Your affections, your attitudes, your attachments, your activities. Many places I could have gone to, and I was tempted to harvest all of them, but thank God. You can thank God I didn't do that. 1 Corinthians 6:9-11. Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you. But, put a red circle around it, you were washed, but you were sanctified, but you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. If you were one of those things before you came to Christ, now you cannot be one of those things anymore. Your activities change. You don't do those old sinful things that pleases the world. In Ephesians 4:1, Paul tells, he's given 3 chapters in Ephesians telling Christians what God thinks about them. It's the most wonderful description of yourself you'll ever find in the Holy Bible. I encourage everyone to study Ephesians 1 through 3. But then he gets to the first verse of chapter 4. Therefore, I, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you, walk worthy of the calling with which you were called. Change the way you walk. Change your lifestyle. Change your activities. Can you look back at your life and say, okay, here's who I was once upon a time. Here I am today. And it's completely different. And I know who made the difference right there in the middle when I came to Jesus Christ. The big change in my life came on 11 February 1979. I've been going through life thinking I'd been saved since I was about 15, summer before my 16th birthday, but just been living like a dog out here for nothing but myself, my own pleasure, all I cared about. I heard the message that turned my life around on February 11, 1979. I couldn't wait for the preacher to shut up and give an invitation so I could run to the front and pour out my heart and give it to Jesus. Not long after that, something inside me started clicking, and I came up with this little testimony. It's a song, actually, but again, in mercy, I'm not going to sing it. Now my mother has a brand new son. My wife has got a brand new husband. That son of mine has got a brand new dad. My life has a new direction. I've been changed to a new perfection, and I'm filled with a brand new joy I never had, because he changes things. My Jesus changes things. I just gave him the key to my heart, and he gave me a brand new start. Now, praise his name, I'll forever sing. My Jesus changes things. Has your life changed since you came to Jesus? If not, you need to understand. My ways, let your eyes observe my ways. Now, here is the benefit to you. It's in Proverbs 18, verses 30 through 32. As for God, his way is perfect. The word of the Lord is proven. He is a shield to all who trust in him. For who is God except the Lord? And who is a rock except our God? Now listen to this. It is God who arms me with strength and makes my way perfect. As for God, his way is perfect. It is God who arms me with strength and makes my way perfect. You want to have the best walk in life you can ever have? Give your heart to God. Let your eyes observe his ways. You know, it's one of the great joys of being pastor of this church for all those years was watching all the little babies being born out there. One of my favorite gigs was go to the hospital the day after the baby's born, hold that little newborn and get my picture taken, you know. Love the little babies. All of us take such pride, you know, when we give birth to a child, and somewhere down the road we can look at it and see some part of ourselves reflected in that child. It looks like daddy. It looks like mama. Well, it doesn't look much like daddy, but right here around the chin, I see a little, you know, we dig deep looking for something because we want those kids to look like us, don't we? So we'll find something. He's got a belly button. So have I. Looks just like me. That kind of thing. We take great pride in having our children resemble us. And then if later on in life they should decide to take the same path, same career path, maybe the same choice of schools or majors in college or same career or join in the family business, they want to be like mom and dad. We take greater pride yet. They look like us and they're walking in our steps. God is not that different from you and I. He wants his children to love him with all their hearts, souls, minds, and strength, to give him our hearts and all that goes with that, and then to walk in his steps. I asked Lauren to find a particular chorus for our invitation song that is really people just like you making that commitment to the Lord. So Lauren, please come for the invitation. And I don't know if God's touched anyone's heart out there in any way. Like I said, I don't want to challenge anyone's salvation, but I want people to take a close look at who you are, what happened, what difference has it made. And then if the Holy Spirit of God says, you know, there's something you need to do today, I want you to come forward and do that. I'll be here to receive you. But as you sing this song, you're singing your commitment, your prayer to Almighty God. And he'll hear that prayer if you sing it with a sincere heart. So please stand. Join in the invitation. If you need to come forward, I'm here to receive you, and I'll help you in any way I possibly can.